Welcome back, geology fans. In the maps and orienteering episodes, we learned the where of our science, and with the minerals and rock episodes, we covered the what. Next up in solving our geologic questions is understanding the when. If we have several rock types in our area, they almost certainly didn't form at the same time. Today, we look into the rules of relative age dating, in which we determine which rocks came first, and thus are older, and which rocks came later, and thus are younger. I've said I'm trying to teach you a new language, and in this language, the letters are the atoms, the words are minerals, and the sentences are the information bomb rocks. We are going to put our information bombs into proper chronological order and take the first steps in telling the story we see in the geology around us. We're about to write geologic paragraphs. To do this, we will use 6 general rules of relative age dating, and by the end of it, you will be able to reconstruct the sequence of events from a cross-section or block diagram like these. The first 5 of these rules are really just basic common sense, and they are based on fundamental physical laws of our world. The 6th rule has a special flavor that we will take a closer look at later. These relative age dating rules are as follows: Law of Original Horizontality, Law of Superposition, Law of Lateral Continuity, Law of Cross-Cutting Relationships, Law of Inclusions, and that last special one, the Law of Fossil Succession. We begin with the Law of Original Horizontality, which was originally proposed in 1669 by a fellow named Nicholas Steno in a book Dissertationis Prodomus, or Dissertation on the First Principles. In this case, the first principles of stratigraphy. In fact, 4 of the rules we will discuss today were laid out in that book, and in many cases it shocks me that these basic rules of what we call stratigraphy, or the study of mainly sedimentary but sometimes volcanic rock layers and layering, that it took so long to discover these laws. The Law of Original Horizontality states that these layered rocks tend to form very close to horizontal, with very few exceptions like foreset beds and deltas or lava flows that run down steeper slopes. You might consider sedimentary crossbed sets not to be originally horizontal, and you'd be right. But those crossbeds are contained within a sedimentary layer that is itself fairly horizontal. The planar surface that all the crossbeds intersect at their base, or the planar surface that cuts off all the crossbed tops, would be the actual bedding plane that would have been originally horizontal. Since layered rock tends to start horizontal to the gravity field, then if we encounter rocks that have been tilted from horizontal, you assume it has been tilted from that original horizontal position. Something such as uplift or general tectonic forces must have been at play to move these rocks from original horizontality. Now, there is a possibility that horizontal layers have been flipped over and upside down, and thus are not originally horizontal, but such a case is usually very localized. A key here is that only small areas can get overturned usually, and very large areas of flat-lying layered rock are very likely to certainly not be overturned. A look across the Grand Canyon lets us know these rock layers are almost certainly not upside down and have not been significantly tilted. When our layers are in their original horizontality, we can most easily discuss Steno's next law, the Law of Superposition. The first layers, the older layers, are on the bottom, and it gets younger towards the top. It's a pretty easy concept, and again, remarkable no one thought to write this out until Steno in 1669. The ground is here first, and then this picture, and then this bunch of dog manure, and then some candy sprinkles on top. You got it? Good. But anyone who's been around knows that not all layers are in their originally horizontal position, and many have been tilted, and some even overturned. How will you, the budding field geologist, figure out which way was the original up direction? Through this series, we have encountered a few features that can be used to give us the original up direction to tell us which layers used to be on the bottom and top. Many of these were sedimentary features, and fortunately, these layers are usually sedimentary. We see mud cracks, which cup upward on their upper surface, bulge out on lower surfaces, and if seen from the side, pinch downward. There are raindrop impressions that put dimples into the top of beds and become dimples bulging out of the bottom of overlying beds. Similarly, Some fossils, like footprints, dinosaur footprints in this case, can give us up direction. A footprint that shows as a depression in the rock surface is telling us that was the upper surface of that bed. But if footprints are seen bulging out of the rock surface, that is the bottom surface, and the prints were actually made in the upper surface of some other material, in this case mud, that has eroded away. Other fossils tell us up direction, such as various burrows that start at a common upper surface and make their network of burrows below. These burrows can fill in with some material more resistant to erosion and end up sticking out of the bottom of the bed. In this case, someone, I swear I didn't do this, poured epoxy into holes at a beach and pulled it out after hardening to reveal a crab's network of burrows. And a doomed little crab. Now, this rock was loose in a Dallas Creek bed, but I immediately knew which way was up from the burrows that are on the underside. And tree stumps go up, and roots go down, and the roots usually get thinner and go to a tip, pointing generally downward. Microbial fossils can form arching fingers or domes called biomats, whose asymmetrical convex shape gives the concave side as down. Cone-in-cone structure usually forms out of clay-rich carbonate mud, but may show up in silica-rich material. It is something to do with the growth of mineral fibers, but beyond that, no one has seen them forming in a modern environment, and so there is still a bit of a mystery surrounding these, but the cones point downward and open upward. Icebergs aren't made of pure ice, but ice plus chunks of rock, from boulder-sized clasts to clay. A floating iceberg can take these clasts into deep, calm water whose dominant sediment may be a fine-grained mud that is forming nice, uniform layers of shale until the glacier drops a larger stone called a drop stone. The layers below get crushed and deformed as the clast settles in, but then further mud deposition creates this draped appearance over the drop stone, and we know deformed layers are on the bottom and draped layers are on top. Or maybe we get a turbidity current in those deep waters, resulting in a graded bed turbidite with the largest particles on the bottom and smaller towards the top. In our secondary sedimentary features, we saw a variety of what are called sole markings, features such as impact and scrape marks, which gouge into the upper surface of the layer, but bulge out of the bottom of the overlying layer. Load sagging and flute marks are similar in bulging out of the bottom of overlying beds. Ripples can't really be said to bulge into or out of a bed as it does both on either face, but ripples have asymmetrically sharper crests and rounder troughs. If the troughs are sharper, then you're probably looking at the bottom of an overlying bed. Often associated with ripples, but seen in side view, are the crossbeds, which have contact with the upper bed closer to a right angle, but the lower part of the crossbed blends in with the lower bedding plane at a much lower angle. There is a concave aspect to these crossbeds as well, and they have a general concavity that is up and in the direction of flow. That fairly well covers the sedimentary layers, and as for the igneous layers, glassy and cracked surfaces tend to be on the upper side, and we might see vesicles, bubbles, trapped in lava flows, which tend to increase towards the top of the lava flow. Some of these vugs, or holes, which can possibly form in other rock types, can fill in partially with sediment, which naturally falls to the bottom half of the hole, and then crystals tend to form in the upper half. Sediment down, crystals up in these vugs. With so many ways to tell original up direction, it's hard not to find one in a sedimentary stack, so we can properly use the law of superposition and know what layers used to be on the bottom and thus are older. The third law after original horizontality and superposition is the law of lateral continuity, which says that these layers don't initially form in a way that suddenly ends. Rather, these layers tend to get thinner and thinner and then pinch out altogether, or they might grade from one type to another or interfinger with other types. If you see layers that break the law of lateral continuity, we immediately jump to the erasing agent of erosion, taking away the missing material. At this outcrop, we see the beds end suddenly at an angle to the upper deposits, and we assume these beds continued from that point, but have been ground down to new sediment and then removed. Conversely, we don't think these layers just end at ground level, but know that they project beneath you as well, and imagining what is below your feet is a large part of field geology. A break in lateral continuity could give us another up indicator as well, as channels cut into the layers below them and then fill in with overlying layered material. Many of these channels have U-shaped bottoms that cut into the layers below and flatter tops. These layers cutting other layers lead to our fourth law of relative age dating, and next to the law of superposition is one of the most useful. This is the law of cross-cutting relationships. Any object that cuts another object has to be younger than the object it cuts. Or the thing being cut had to be there first to get cut. What came first, this picture or the rip in this picture? You get the picture? If a dike cuts a cross-country rock, the dike is younger than the country rock. If a fault cuts a rock formation, the fault came after the rock formation. If layers of rock get cut by other layers of rock, the layers doing the cutting are younger. What came first here? That is, what is older? This dark-colored amphibolite or the light-colored feldspar and quartz vein? If you said the dark amphibolite was there first and then later got cut by the vein, then give yourself a high five. Six! We had six rules of relative age dating, but Steno only gave us these four. The thing is, you can do most of the relative age dating with just these four, and you get your rocks in pretty much order. The fifth rule came at the beginning of the 1800s, presented by Charles Lyell in his book Principles of Geology. This is the law of inclusions, or law of included fragments. It says that any piece of rock inside of, included within, another rock has to be older than the rock that it is in. A xenolith, which we recall is a piece of country rock wall that was ripped off by intruding magma and ends up as a piece of foreign rock floating within a cooled igneous rock. This xenolith is older than the igneous rock it is in. That country wall rock was there first and is older than later was frozen into the younger igneous rock. A reworked fossil that later ends up in a new deposit was around before it was deposited in its new encompassing sediment. A conglomerate is made of many pieces of rock, and in fact, any clastic rock is so made. We can say that every piece was part of a previously existing rock that was weathered and eroded and eventually deposited to become part of this newer and younger conglomerate rock. Now we're up to five laws of relative age dating. All five of these come out of basic physical principles and are sufficient to order any sequence of rock you may encounter. But once you have ordered your rock formations, then take a look at the fossils inside of these rocks. You see they are not scattered randomly at all. There is a progression of forms in these rocks as one group of life form succeeds another, becoming more and more like the modern display of life towards the top. This is our sixth and final law, the law of fossil succession or faunal succession. This law is not a law in the sense of the other five, which are falling out of basic physics and logic. This one reveals itself after you have used original horizontality, superposition, lateral continuity, cross-cutting relationships, and included fragments to order your stack. It is also different because Italian Steno didn't propose it in the 17th century, and Englishman William Smith proposed it in the 19th century. And his story will be the subject of our next episode, here on Earth Explorations.